before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness, you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercy and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul, till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul, where brilliant light is all.
You say Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see you this morning here at Nova Community Church. Welcome to all of you, especially those who are here for their first time. Welcome to Nova Community Church, our worship gathering on Sunday at 9:30. For the worship bulletin, it's online. It's right on your phone at novachurch.org or on the Nova Community Church app. And while you're thinking about your phone, how about this? Let's all double check our phone right now.
Do I need to?
I'm not kidding. Double check your phone to make sure it's on silent, because no one wants to hear your ring during the middle of the sermon. Or that didn't happen last week, did it? Maybe
no.
Three times it didn't happen. Okay.
Of course
and
not.
And no one wants to hear that you're, you know, someone's at your front door, you're getting Amazon delivery on your ring, or you got a text. And so no one wants to know that.
Sure.
So other than that, welcome everybody to Nova Community Church. Welcome to those of you who are online and those of you who are in our outdoor venue. I gotta tell you that last week was our collection for Operation Christmas Child, sending those shoe boxes all over the world to kids. And we collected over 90 shoe boxes and we delivered it to the place. And so we're excited about that. And so more than 90 kids, of course, around the world, just thousands of them are gonna get Christmas presents through the shoe box and have a gospel message this Christmas. So we're really excited about that.
Something else that Nova gets to do every Christmas season is we partner with an orphanage, a Christian shelter in the Tijuana area of Mexico called Colina de Luz. And what we do is we give Christmas gifts to the children who live there as well as the staff. We each sponsor a child or a worker. There's a little tag that says what they want. We go and buy it and we give it to them. There is a booth out on the front porch that has all of the different people, the children, the workers on there. And so you can go over there, sponsor a child, buy a gift for them, and then bring it back. We are going, just a little heads up on this, we are only going to be taking sponsors this week and next week, because the following week we're actually going to be taking the gifts to Mexico, the weekend of the 9th and 10th. There's about 65 people in total, so I encourage you to please go check that out. Go sponsor a child or a worker or two or three or four, because it's a really cool opportunity. There's also the opportunity, if you want to go on that trip down to Mexico and actually deliver the gifts in person, a little short-term missions trip there, you can talk to the workers at that booth because that is totally available as well. It's a really, really cool thing we do every year.
That's right. Colina de Luz.
Colina de Luz. That
means?
Hill of Light.
You guys look puzzled when I said that. Okay. Hill of Light.
And yeah.
So I've been there. It's great.
It's awesome. It's a great time.
It's
very cool.
This month is our opportunity for all of us. We give to what's called a Joy to the World offering, and it's an offering to send a Christmas gift to our missionaries all around the world. There's a list of them in your online bulletin. You can take a look. November 30th is the last day to give to the Joy to the World offering. You just mark your check with the memo line, Joy to the World, or you can go to the online giving, the drop-down menu, Joy to the World offering, and that gift will be set aside and given to missionaries all over the world.
And then the last thing we're going to be announcing today is we're doing an Advent devotional again this Christmas season. And this Advent devotional was written by many of you. Each day of Advent, how many days in total is it in Advent? All right. We don't know. There's a good amount. It's 4 weeks. The 4 weeks leading up to Christmas, each day outside of Sundays, there is a devotional that was written by the people of Nova Community Church. That's going to start not tomorrow, but the following Monday. And so there's a few different things with that. There will be physical copies if you would like a physical copy, available next week. You can also just access the devotional on the novachurch.org website, or if you would like each day's devotional emailed to you, first thing in the morning, there is a sign up on the novachurch.org website as well. Just enter in your email address and you will get each day's devotional every single morning. So just giving you a heads up about that. That's going to be starting not tomorrow, but the following Monday.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. That's my turn on that. Yeah. I got one more. Hey, let's all stand up and say hi to some of the folks around you. It's good to see you today.
Many of our friends are out of town this week, so you've got to make up for all of that. We're going to sing our praise to the Lord. He's an awesome God. All right, sing it out to Him. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. He is. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. Our God is great. He's robed in majesty. He rules with power, He reigns in victory. And there's no one else who can compare with Him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God, well, He's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wind. Power and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. He's great. Our God is great. He's robed in majesty. He rules with power. He reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with Him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God. Yeah, He's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Yeah, that's right. And if that's true, think of how it's just one word He speaks that changes everything in our lives. He's the God who changes lives. Say the word.
Say the word and there is life. Say the word and dead bones rise. Every start and end hangs on your voice. For your word never returns void. The word and there is life.
Say the word.
Say the word and dead bones rise. Every start and and hangs on your voice. For your word never returns void. Written in a billion, written in a billion skies, speaking to this heart of mine, and all that I am with all creation, hanging on every word that you've spoken. It will not be shaken. We're clinging for life to all you promised, hanging on every word that you said. Word made flesh, word made flesh, you wrote in grace. Promise kept through cross and grave. All the words of stone you spelled out, love. And when you say it is done, it is done. And written in a billion skies, speaking to this heart of mine, all that I am with all creation, hanging on every word that you've spoken. It will not be shaken. We're clinging for life to all you promised, Lord, hanging on every word that you've written in a billion skies. You're speaking to this heart of mine, and all that I am with all creation, hanging on every word that you've spoken. It will not be shaken. We're clinging for life to all you promised, and hanging on every word that you've said. Say the word. Say the word and there is life. Say the word and dead bones rise. Every start and end hangs on your voice. For your word never returns void.
Open up my eyes in
wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Sing Jesus again. Sing it out. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are. Please fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Your love, it is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Oh, open up my eyes and wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lay me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a
this morning we want to lead you in a song that's new to Nova. It's one that Audrey and I and Dave and Claire and Leland and McKenna sang last week at the father-daughter retreat up at Hume Lake. And it's a worship song about worship, actually, and worship's capacity, its power to transform us, or rather the Lord transforms us when we come to Him in worship. A remarkable thing happens right in the middle of some of the darkest, most depressing psalms in all of Scripture. The psalms, of course, are the songbook of the Bible. And I love the fact that the writers of the psalms don't sugarcoat anything. They don't pull punches. They don't hold back. They're brutally honest about the tough stuff of life. And God, I think, invites that kind of honesty. He's big enough. He can take it. In some of these psalms, the writers begin lamenting life. They're looking around at the world, and their song is lament to God. You know, things like, why is the world so unfair? God, what's up with that? Or God, how is it that I live my life and all these terrible things happen to me? Or even, God, it feels like you've abandoned me. You've turned your back on me. My favorite psalm in all of the Bible is one of these. It's Psalm 73. And the speaker begins taking stock of his own life, and then he looks at the lives of those around him. And that's mistake number one, right? I mean, nothing good comes from that kind of comparison. But he says, God, I try to live an upright life. I strive to please you in what I do. And then I look at the ungodly, people who couldn't care less about you or your ways, Father. And they seem to be thriving. They're fit. They're attractive. The verses actually say their bodies are strong and healthy. And they seem to live carefree lives without not a worry in the world. And yet, God, I serve you, and my life is difficult. My life is a life of suffering. He even says at one point, Father, I try to understand this, and it's oppressive to me. These people that live these comfortable, cushy, cozy, contented lives, and your people suffer. But then this remarkable thing happens. He says, it was oppressive to me until I entered your sanctuary. In other words, until I came before you in worship. And then God sets him straight. God shows them things as they really are. God shows them the true state of things. We're going to sing this bridge at one point. Can we put that on screen? This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you. We praise you. In other words, you want to know what living looks like? Well, look to the one who created life. You want to know what freedom feels like? Then worship the Lord. You know, the English teacher in me wants to punctuate this. Could we punctuate it? There we go. I mean, with that colon at the end of the third line, this is what heaven sounds like. It's putting God first. You want heaven here and now? It's a matter of learning to praise the Lord, learning to seek him first. I certainly don't think this song means that heaven's going to sound more or less like what we do on Sunday mornings. No offense to anyone, especially the people with me on the platform, but I think that heaven will sound a whole lot better than this. We're fairly decent singers at Nova. We struggle sometimes to clap to the rhythm, but we're fairly decent singers. But no, that's not what it's saying. It's saying you want heaven here and now, and learn to praise the Lord. Because when we come to him that way, he changes everything about the way that we see and experience everything. The song is simply called We Praise You, and the lyrics flow fast, but join us when you got the hang of it and you're comfortable with it. Like this. Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. Sing with all we are, we claim your victory. So let it rise, let praise arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high, with all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, good. Next verse. Let faith be the song that overcomes the rage and save. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise.
let faith arise. We'll sing and break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. But they cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what heaven looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what heaven looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall and watch the giants fall. For they cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 oh. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. That's right. Amen. Please be seated.
In just a little bit, the Nova kids will be released to meet their teachers in the back of the worship center. But for now, would you join your hearts with mine as we pray together? Dear Heavenly Father, on this Sunday of Thanksgiving week, you certainly have our attention and you have our love. And we know that we would be lost without you. God, we are people who are in desperate need every day. We need your love and your kindness that leads us to repentance. And we need your leadership. We need your guidance because many times we find ourselves lost and confused. And we need you to strengthen and empower us because by ourselves we're ineffective on our own. Therefore, with humble hearts, we ask you for supernatural intervention. In everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, we present our request to you. We know that you are the God that can heal. So we boldly ask that you would bring healing and make preparations in advance for members of the Nova Church family who are going through medical procedures and dealing with illnesses this week. And we thank you. We thank you for being the healer of broken and grieving hearts and the God of all comfort who comforts us in our time of need. Lift the spirits of those who are depressed and sad and are experiencing relational conflict and loss today. And Jesus, you came into our world to set us free, not to weigh us down. You came in this world to grace us, not to shame us. And you know all the ways that we are victims and agents of sin and brokenness, and yet you pursue and you welcome and you love us. Jesus, may we spend the rest of Thanksgiving week grateful for you, our Savior, Creator of all things, our gentle shepherd, Prince of Peace, Friend of sinners. In your wonderful name, amen.
Good morning. So great to be here worshiping together today. So I was preparing for this message today. I was thinking most buildings are not built overnight. First, there's an idea that there even needs to be a building. Then maybe there's a rendering or a drawing, something that's showing what the building's going to look like when it's done, when it's finished. Next, there's blueprints with all kinds of details and measurements and specifications. I'm probably leaving some stuff out too, but then there's the gathering of money and materials that will be needed for construction. When the plans are finished and the funding is in place, you can break ground and start construction. And so now we're at the actual construction, which can take months or sometimes years, depending on the building. And even after the construction is done, the building still has to be furnished. Then it's finally ready for occupancy. We've been following the story of God's people through the Old Testament book of Exodus. And in our story, we've seen God rescue his people out of Egypt, provide for them all along their journey, lead them as he forms them into his people. We've heard the people declare their obedience and their faith, but we've also heard them grumble and complain. We've seen the people follow God's instruction, but we've also seen them take matters into their own hands. We've heard God be both merciful and just in his dealings with his people. And at this point in the journey through Exodus, we've already been given the instructions for the building of the tabernacle. That was a few chapters ago. This is the place where God will come meet his people, his tabernacle. And at this point in the story, there's been an unexpected delay, as there often is with building projects. But this one was a little different. The people had sinned. They had set up an alternative worship service around the golden calf that they made as an idol. But God had forgiven their sin through Moses' intercession, and now they're ready to start construction. Now, before we get into the next part of the text, the book of Exodus, I want to say just a couple things about this whole next section of the book itself, the few chapters. Exodus chapters 35 through 39 may seem redundant. As you read these chapters, you'll notice that they're almost a word-for-word repetition of earlier chapters, chapters 25 through 31. Sometimes our tendency is to skim through repetition like this, or even skip over it completely. However, it's not good to skip things in the Bible. When God repeats himself, there's a reason, and usually a good one. And when we pause to think about it, actually, there's a few things to note about repetition itself. Repetition was actually common in ancient literature. Repetition was is accepted, I can say today, as a good way to tell a story. Repetition can build suspense. Repetition also reinforces memory. That's how we remember things. We repeat it. But I think there's another reason that Exodus repeats itself, a more important reason in this particular case. And this particular repetition, it's even hard to say repetition, this particular repetition, it's in place to showcase Israel's obedience. Like us, the Israelites had a hard time following God's instruction sometimes. They had a hard time doing what God said. The first time that God gave them his plans for the tabernacle, they weren't really paying close attention. Then they went off and they were doing their own thing. And this led to trouble. Remember, the making of the golden calf as an idol and worshiping it as a nation. That's what I mean by trouble. But this time, they're actually setting out to obey God's instructions. And so this seeming redundancy, it's there in these chapters for a wonderful reason, to show Israel's obedience. Our passage for today will be Exodus chapters 35 and 36. You can turn in your Bibles to the beginning of Exodus 35, either your physical Bible on an app. Our notes for today are also available through the Nova Community Church app and on our website, and the main passages we're going to highlight are included in your notes. We will not be reading through the entirety of these two chapters, but we'll focus on some different sections, and we'll look at these in some different parts rather than reading them all at one time. But our first part comes from the beginning of Exodus 35, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 4 through 10. So I'll begin and I'll read this passage for us. Exodus 35, beginning in verse 1. Moses assembled the whole Israelite community and said to them, "These are the things the Lord has commanded you to do. For 6 days work is to be done, but the seventh day shall be your holy day, a day of Sabbath rest to the Lord. Whoever does any work on it is to be put to death." And then we'll move to verse 4. Moses said to the whole Israelite community, "This is what the Lord has commanded. From what you have, take an offering for the Lord. Everyone who is willing is to bring to the Lord an offering of gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn and fine linen, goat hair, ram's skins dyed red and another type of durable leather, acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, and onyx stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and the breastpiece. All who are skilled among you are to come and make everything the Lord has commanded." God's word for us today, Exodus 35, 1 and 2, and verses 4 through 10. As we begin this next part of the story of Exodus, the Israelites, as I said, are in the place where they're about to begin the construction of the tabernacle, the actual building of it. Remember, God's already given them the specifics of how to do this and what to use. And here, God also gives some more instruction through Moses. One important thing here is they're to remember their holy day, the Sabbath. This is where it begins. Even with the task as important as building God's tabernacle, the task is not as important as who the task is for. In other words, don't get caught up in the project and forget worship. This is an incredible reminder right at the beginning of the building of the tabernacle. It's also a great reminder for me, too, because I'm a task-oriented person. Left to my own, I'll sit in my office and close the door and just try to get a whole bunch of work done. I'm a task-oriented person, and so this is a fantastic reminder at the beginning of this project. So that's one important thing. In addition to just the instructions they had given through Moses. The next important thing mentioned is that they were to take an offering, with each person giving out of what they have. It's worth noting that there's not a specific way to give or a specific amount that's specified for each person. And this kind of flies in the face of what we might think today, if you've been involved in raising funds for anything at all. Some fundraisers would have advised Moses to tell everybody how much they're supposed to give, or at least communicate a suggested amount for donation. This was actually Aaron's approach when he made the golden calf. He told them what to give, and he had them bring it and give it. But God's way is different than ours. God told his people to bring their offerings, to build the tabernacle, to make the furnishings, and to dress the priests. And as we will see over these next few chapters, this is exactly what they'll do. God's way is different, and God is lifted up and exalted when we do what he tells us to do and not doing it our way. For the next part of the story, we're going to move down in Exodus 35 to verse 20. Then the whole Israelite community withdrew from Moses' presence, and everyone who was willing and whose heart moved them came and brought an offering to the Lord for the work on the tent of meeting, for all its service, and for the sacred garments. Exodus 35, verses 20 and 21 from God's word. After Moses asked them to give, he sent them home to decide what they should give. This is interesting. Moses doesn't use any manipulative techniques. Nobody was asked to make a quick decision or a public decision about what they were going to give. There was no manipulation here. And the fuller text of the chapter, we didn't read the whole thing, but it'll go on. And it says things like this, and it comments, everyone came whose heart was stirred, everyone whose spirit was willing, all the women whose hearts were stirred, a free will offering to the Lord. This idea of the freedom in the offering, it's repeated and it's emphasized over and over multiple times. So we see that the people gave what they could, because not everybody could give gold or precious gems. They just couldn't. Some could only give goat's hair. And it sounds maybe kind of funny, but certainly a gift of goat's hair would have been just as welcome in God's sight as a gift of gold, especially when given with the right heart. Because after all, goat's hair was on the list of things that were needed for the building of the tabernacle. And so it's good to remember this offering came from God's command, not from Moses' clever fundraising techniques. This also reveals God's normal way of providing for and channeling resources into his work through the gifts given from his people with a willing heart. This is how God works. In our story, let's look ahead to verses 30 through 35 of the same chapter, Exodus 35, 30 through 35. Then Moses said to the Israelites, "See, the Lord has chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and he has filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of artistic crafts. And he has given both him and Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan, the ability to teach others. He has filled them with skill to do all kinds of work as engravers, designers, embroiderers in blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and fine linen, and weavers, all of them skilled workers and designers." In God's word, we see here that it is more than just finances that were given. There's all kinds of materials, and they all came from the Israelites. The people gave from what they had, and this is the way that they participated in God's work. In the church today, we have similar opportunities to give to God. Everything that we have comes from him in the first place, right? And now it's our privilege to use it for his service. And so we bring our financial offerings for supporting God's work. And some of the money goes to the building where we meet and gather for worship. Some of it goes to the pastor so he can devote his life to the ministry of God's word. Some of it goes to other staff who help us to grow in grace and serve Jesus and the church. Some of it goes to outreach among the poor and the lost in the community. Some of it goes to support the work of missions in our community and around the world. Our financial offerings really do support gospel ministry through God's local church here at Nova, and that's important. But there's another aspect of giving that's also important. We offer God also what we do. Building the tabernacle took more than precious metals and wood and fine fabrics. It also required the use of people's talents. Making all these things required a large number of people with a wide range of skills. This is an important principle that also applies in the church today, because the Bible teaches that every Christian has spiritual gifts, and God uses these gifts to build his kingdom. It also teaches that we should use the particular gifts that God has given us. The New Testament talks about teachers should teach, leaders should lead, helpers should help, and so on. The Israelites gave to God out of their finances. They also gave to God out of what they do. And we should also note that not only did the people do the right thing in giving to God, they also did it, the text tells us, for the right reason. It's important to understand how the people gave. They gave willingly and from the heart. And this is the kind of giving, really, that God always wants. More than anything else, what God wants from us is our hearts. No matter what we give or what we do, God wants it to flow out of who we are. Something that happens next in our story, it's very interesting. It's kind of amazing, I think, actually. And this is in chapter 36 of Exodus. Chapter 36, verses 1 through 7. And so Bezalel, Oholiab, and every skilled person to whom the Lord has given skill and ability to know how to carry out all the work of constructing the sanctuary are to do the work just as the Lord has commanded. And then Moses summoned Bezalel and Oholiab and every skilled person to whom the Lord had given ability and who was willing to come and do the work. They received from Moses all the offerings the Israelites had brought to carry out the work of constructing the sanctuary. And the people continued to bring freewill offerings morning after morning. So all the skilled workers who were doing all the work on the sanctuary left what they were doing and said to Moses, "The people are bringing more than enough for doing the work the Lord commanded to be done." Then Moses gave an order, and they sent this word throughout the camp: "No man or woman is to make anything else as an offering for the sanctuary." And so the people were restrained from bringing more because what they already had was more than enough to do all the work. Exodus 36, verses 1 through 7. This is really interesting. And here we see this magnificent picture of generosity. Moses had to tell them to stop giving. After they had brought enough, they were told to stop. On a side note, this also shows the integrity of Moses. He didn't gather more than what was needed. God told him to take an offering for the building of the tabernacle. And when the tabernacle was provided for, the offering was over. Their purpose wasn't to collect an endless amount of resources, but it was to put those resources into action to do God's work and accomplish God's will. And chapter 36 of Exodus continues in the very next verse. We're just going to read the first part of verse 8. And it tells us, all those who were skilled among the workers made the tabernacle. And the rest of chapter 36, we're not going to read the whole thing. But it details the building of the tabernacle exactly according to the instruction they were given. Basically, word for word, detail for detail. This time, the Israelites weren't just paying attention. They were locked in. They were completely focused. Not building a god of their own, an idol, and worshiping it, but locked in and focused on what God was having them do. And they were participating in God's plan, and they were following God's instructions for them. And they knew not only God's plan, but they also knew God's mercy firsthand, because he didn't destroy them after their huge mistake. They made this idol and they worship another god. And God even said, if you remember the text, that he was going to destroy them. And he didn't. He relented. And so they knew God's mercy firsthand. Building the tabernacle was the task that they were called to do. And their obedience itself was a contribution to God's work. And it wasn't just certain people, we read in the text, or just the leaders, like the two mentioned, Bezalel and Oholiab. The whole nation was invited to contribute to the tabernacle, and everyone had something to give. And these few chapters in the book of Exodus, they go through all of this in detail, word for word, point for point. They show and they highlight and they proclaim the obedience of God's people as they build the tabernacle. And so this here, it's a beautiful showcase now of Israel's obedience after their mistake. Here at Nova, we've recently gone through a building campaign of our own. If you've been around these last few years, you've watched and seen the different aspects as we've journeyed through the different stages of the Open Project and the process, from the dreaming and the drawings, through the funding, and on into the construction and delays. Thankfully, our delays were not because of a false idol and the wrong kind of worship. Different kind of delays, construction delays. But for the Israelites, the story didn't end when the building project was completed. We don't get there in our chapters today, but the story doesn't end there. And our story doesn't end there either. The journey of obeying God and living our lives for Him, it continues. And while we may not always be building something, and while we especially aren't always building a tabernacle, we're part of the same mission, to make God's glory known. Jesus told us to make disciples of all nations. In other words, to fill the earth with worshipers. That's one paraphrase. That's a Pastor Adam paraphrase of that verse. Jesus tells us to fill His earth with people who are going to worship Him and follow Him. And while we're not necessarily worshiping in the tabernacle like the Israelites were, we are worshiping with our lives. In this part of Exodus, all the supplies needed for making everything were listed out. But there was also a call for the craftsmen. It wasn't just about the supplies. All of the people were told to contribute, to be a part of the mission of God. We read that when Moses called for the craftsmen, the text tells us everyone whose heart moved him came to do the work. So not only was everybody involved in the offering, everybody was involved in some way in building God's house. And if you're supposed to be a part of the mission of God, I think you need to ask an important question. Because again, the text said, everyone whose heart moved him. And that question is this: where's your heart? The Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. We need this kind of heart. This is what the Israelites lived out. And that scene had to have been amazing. The people willingly giving and doing so generously. But generous giving only comes from a heart that is moved or has been moved by God's grace. When we give, we show that we've been moved by God's grace. The Apostle Paul also wrote this a little earlier in the same letter, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. Generosity, generous giving, comes from a heart that's been changed, something deep inside of us. And so that's one question that's important to ask. Where is your heart? There's another one, though, that's good too. And it's simply this: what will you give? Where's your heart, and what will you give? There's any number of things that a person may give. For instance, we can give treasures, like money or materials. Some of the Israelites gave those. But what were the Israelites really giving? They were giving what God had given them. These items, gold and silver, and bronze and wood, spices, oil, fancy threads. These were all the things that they had received when he rescued them out of Egypt, if you remember back early on in our story. And so when we bring our offerings, just like the Israelites, we're simply giving back to God what he has given us. He blesses us. It's all his anyway. It's really not even mine. And so we're giving back to God what he has given us. That's one thing we can give. We can give treasures. Another gift that can be given is the gift of time. It took time for for them to do all this work. It takes time for us to do things too. And it's the same with us. One of the most precious things that we have, I've heard it said so many times in my life, is time. And we should spend our time wisely on the things that matter. So we can give our treasures, we can give our time, and another gift that we can give is our talent. People who were blessed with certain skills built the tabernacle, it said. Both men and women, it says. This is how God works. He gifts believers to build up his body, and we're to use what we have for his mission, for the mission of God and for the glory of God. So we give of treasures, time, and talents. Over these next few weeks, we'll be journeying through the holidays. Is it okay to talk about that for a minute? Thanksgiving, Advent, Christmas, New Year's Day. There's a lot on the horizon. And throughout this time, though, God's mission continues. We are to make disciples. That is what we're to be about as a church. And here at Nova, we do talk about offerings, the different ones that there are, the different ways that people can give. And this is because we want you to be participants in God's work, working on God's mission through the ministry of this local church. And I'll say that again. We talk about those things because we want you to be participants in the ministry of God through this local church. And this time of year especially, there's a variety of different things. The Joy to the World offering, Operation Christmas Child, which just wrapped up this last week, Nova's Benevolence Fund, Colina de Luz, and you can get more information about that starting today. And our regular ongoing ministries all around Nova. And giving to these involves not just finances, but our time and our talents. And I want to give a heartfelt thank you to all of you for your hearts, your generosity, your prayers, and your gifts. I know that you give faithfully of all of these things, your treasures, your time, and your talents, to support the ministries of Nova and also the ministries that Nova is connected with. So thank you for being a part of the mission of God. That's a wonderful and amazing thing. The story of the tabernacle shows that God's grace is the best motivation for giving. We don't give out of a sense of duty. We don't give out of a sense of guilt. We don't give because we're being forced into it or coerced to give. Out of gratitude for what he has done to save us, God invites us to join his mission and make free will offerings to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ. As you journey through the holidays and beyond, I encourage you to ask those important questions. Where is your heart? And what will you give? And I encourage you to join in the mission of God as you give of your treasure, time, and talent with a joyful and grateful heart. Amen. Amen. Will you pray with me? Father God, thank you for your word, which teaches us about who you are and what you want us to do. Thank you that you allow us to be a part of your mission, of your kingdom, of building your church here on earth, even though it's not the building of a tabernacle like we read about in Exodus. But we thank you for these words. We ask that you guide our hearts and our minds. Keep us close to you. Hold us in your arms of love. Help us to remember who you are and what it is that you want us to do as we go from this place each Sunday and especially into the other days of the week, Father God. Guide us in your ways. Show us who needs your love. Show us how we can continue to show people your love and your kingdom, and to do so for your glory. Be with us as we worship with our lives and as we give back to you what you have blessed us with. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Would you stand for the benediction today? In Romans 12, verse 1, we read this. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. As you go from here today, may you contribute to the mission of God through a lifestyle of worship. Amen.
Faith be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let faith be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all that we are and we claim your victory. Let it rise, let praise arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 oh. Let faith be a song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Oh, let it rise. Let faith arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, oh, oh. Looks like this is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll sing you knock every wall. Watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of faith on our side. Forever lift him high. with all creation cry, God, we praise, see you break down every wall. Watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of strength is on our side. Forever lift hands high. With all creation cries, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 yeah, we praise you, Lord. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything.